Thank you for tuning into The Point. Join with us in worship.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Thank you.
Hey guys, what's up and welcome to The Point. My name is Pastor Jonathan and I have the honor and privilege of leading around here. I just want you all to know that if this is your first time or 101st time that I care about you, that I believe in you, and keep crushing it for the kingdom of heaven. And if you haven't got an expectation for this video, then right now, man, I encourage you to get one. If you've never experienced the love of Jesus, you've come to the right place and you'll have a great opportunity to meet him this evening. Also, if you haven't yet, feel free to follow me on Instagram and like my Facebook page or any other social media platform at PJ at the Point. Tonight, we're gonna jump back into our sermon series called Misunderstood. And there are some things that I want to clear up that I've heard, or maybe just a mindset of, or maybe even false viewpoints. And in Christianity, honestly, it doesn't help anyone for us to continue to think them, or worse, believe them. So it's going to get real open and honest. Tonight's topic, which is actually going to be two parts, is that as Christians, we don't and won't always feel close to God. So we're going to be discussing what I believe to be the two most common viewpoints as to why we don't always feel close to God. So tonight we're going to dive into part one. And I know some may say, I've always felt close to God. I've never once had a doubt. And to that, I would respond, stop lying. See, we're a church of guts and it takes guts to admit that we're not always feeling like God is right next to us. And for some, I know that feeling right there causes them to question their faith or maybe even walk away. And I firmly believe that this isn't talked about enough. I especially don't believe that new believers and students are given the opportunity to think that it may be possible that after they first accept Christ, that there may come a day that there's a period of time that it seems that God isn't returning your text, that even though it says red, because we all know God would have an iPhone, but still no response. So students, if you're not feeling close to God in this time, I want you to know that it's okay. That you're not alone, that this is actually just a season and it may be a dry season for you, but that doesn't mean in a dry season that you just sit and do nothing and wait for the rain. If you're not in a dry season and you feel angels are chilling with you daily in your devotion time, then guess what? Start preparing for the season that I'm about to be speaking on, because it will come. And here's the truth, whatever season you're in, whether it be the harvest or planting, the feast or famine, it will change. The question becomes, are you ready and what are you gonna do about it? So say the season is a dry one, meaning, man, you're just not feeling it. God seems so distant. Guess what? You're not alone. And I'm not talking about just the millions of people that are in the same boat, but did you know that Jesus actually felt the same way? See, we all know that he was doing what he was supposed to and he still felt away from God, right? Even if it was a short period. But how could that be? What proof do you have, PJ? Well, let's go ahead and look at the Bible and check it out. Matthew 27:46 says this, about 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? See, Jesus is crying out to God, why have you forsaken me? Think about this. If you don't know the story of Jesus' ministry, let's take a couple of minutes and let's look at the last 3 years prior. So this is a highlight reel, tell of the tape, whatever you want to call it. So he changed water into wine, John 2:1-11, so be sure to read that. He healed a royal official's son, that's John 4:46-54. There was the healing of the paralytic at Bethesda in John 5:1-15. There's the feeding of the 5,000 in John 6:5-14. Jesus walking on water in John 6:16-24. Jesus raised a widow's son in Luke 7:11-17. And also, I believe that Jesus knew the sins of the men that were trying to stone the woman for being caught in adultery. And what he did was he actually wrote them in the sand, and ultimately that's what saved her life. And that's in John 8:1-11. He healed the blind in John 9:1-7. He raised Lazarus in John 11:1-45. So how about the, you know, miraculous, the catching of fish, you know, where Jesus is walking by and these professional fishermen and they've been fishing all night. And then Jesus is like, yo, throw the net on the other side. And they catch far more than they've ever caught before, like ever. That actually happened in John 21:1-14. So then let me ask this question. Would you say that Jesus is connected with God? If all those miracles are happening, the answer has to be yes, right? Is he walking out his purpose? Is he walking out his calling? Well, let's check out scripture, John 3:17, and I feel like everyone knows John 3:16, but John 3:17 is actually just as important. It says, "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." So the question is, how is he going to save the world through himself? And we all know the answer, right? And if you don't, it's the crucifixion. So he's going to be crucified on the cross. And so the answer to that question of, is he walking out his purpose and is he walking out, you know, in his purpose? The answer is yes. And guess what? He still, after everything, had a moment where he felt abandoned from God. But then what happened? After the resurrection, which is a miracle, right? He showed himself to Thomas, which is another miracle. He was on the earth still for 40 days, another miracle. And then he gave them the instruction in what has formed how we do church today and how we're believing in Jesus 2,000 years later, right? Some of you might be saying, well, how is this relevant? And it's because even after a dry season, you can expect the rain. You can expect blessing and wisdom and power and boldness to come out of a dry season if you respond correctly. A dry season won't defeat you and it won't always be dry if you do the things God has called you to do, even when you don't feel him close. Your parents sometimes alter your behavior by being around, right? Obviously, I've seen some of you without your parents. I've seen you with your parents. Okay, cool. Check this out. Certain things you aren't going to do because they're close, but maybe whenever they're not around, things might get a little bit more loose, right? Well, to put it nicely. Well, tons of Christians are like that with God. You know, as soon as that high emotion or major conviction is gone, maybe they're no longer loving or disciplined or kind or gentle or peaceful, or joyful, you know, bearing fruit of the Spirit. But we have to remain faithful even in the desert. Also, for the record, guys, students, check this. If you kept the high standard that you have for your own personal behavior when your parents are around, for whenever they weren't, your life will be much easier. Just saying, but anyways, I'll leave that to your parents. I'm gonna give you the key to doing this in the dry season, and that is develop strong godly habits when you feel his presence in abundance. Like if his presence was money, you'd be sitting on racks, and for the old people, that's thousands. Instead of buying flashy things though, like Yeezys or Lululemon, ladies, I've never heard of that before, but I just saw it on Facebook and apparently it's a thing. But here's the deal, strong godly habits are like you're investing in IRAs and stock market and retirement funds, things that are, well, boring. And people aren't gonna be like, man, great job putting $250 in your savings account like they would if you just bought some AirPods Pro. But this is what I need you to understand, that investment into your savings account will catch you if you ever fall financially. You can't pay for your gas with AirPods if you lose a job, okay? That's really the same principle as far as what doing the little things will do for you in your walk with Christ, and especially in those times of abundance. Every scripture you read, every prayer you make, that's going into savings. That's building you up. That's what will keep you going when you're unsure. If you don't know where your next paycheck is coming from, it is way easier to be still if there's something in that savings account. If you're unsure what God has for you in a dry season, it's easier for your spirit to be at still if you've got the word from the Lord still from that abundant season. So whichever season you're in, be sure to be growing in spiritual discipline, but it's especially good to go deeper and develop good habits while things seem to be super smooth. Don't take your foot off the gas, don't coast, punch it. Joseph actually teaches us this in Genesis 41:53-57. It says this, "The 7 years of abundance in Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began, just as Joseph had said. There was famine in all the other lands, but in the whole land of Egypt there was food. When all of Egypt began to feel the famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for food. Then Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, 'Go to Joseph and do what he tells you.' When the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout Egypt. And all the world came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe everywhere." All right, so check this out, right? The famine was everywhere. Just because Joseph had a storehouse full didn't mean that there still wasn't a famine. It just means that in the famine, Joseph was good. So we all have seasons, but the question you have to ask yourself is, what season are you in and are you good for the next one? If your current season is not knowing Christ, I want you to know that the best decision that you can make is accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And I'm about to give you the opportunity to accept the greatest gift you can ever imagine, because I need you to know this. God loves you so much that he sent his only son, Jesus, who died for you, so you don't have to spend an eternity in hell, but you can spend an eternity in heaven with him. The Bible says that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that you'll be saved. So that's what I believe. And maybe you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, but things may have got a little dry. Maybe that flame has started to get dim. Well, tonight is your night as well. Ask yourself the simple question, are you right with God? Take a second, answer that question. And if the answer is no, when you want to commit to being what Christ is calling you to be and accept His grace for the first time, or maybe you need to get back on track, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes, and I'm going to ask you to say a prayer with me. And there's nothing special about the prayer. It's really about the relationship that comes after it that's incredible. And this is just really to open up the line of communication between you and God. So repeat this after me. Dear Jesus, I'm sorry for my actions, for my attitudes, and my decisions. But I promise from this day forward that I'll be what you call me to be. I'll be who you call me to be. I believe that I'm saved. I believe that I'm changed. I believe that I'll never be the same. It's in your heavenly name I pray. Amen. And guess what? If you just said that prayer and you're a student, can you do me a huge favor and send a message to the Point page? I would really like to, you know, pray with you and pray over you, as well as give you some next steps with how to get closer to the Lord and more connected with us at the Point. And if you're an adult, can you take the time to message the Connection Point page and let Pastor Darren know, because he's an incredible guy that would love to pray with you and over you and help you with the next steps and how you can get connected to God and also with us here at Connection Point. But one last thing though, I'm going to pray really quickly for those that are in a dry season. And if that's you, I'm going to ask you just to raise your hands wherever you're at. And let's agree together in prayer for God's outpouring in your life. Gracious Heavenly Father, God, I just thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we have to gather in your name. Lord, even if it's over video, I know that your word says where two or three are gathered, Lord God, that you are there. So I know that your presence is here and your presence is wherever they're watching. God, as we're lifting our hands to you, I just pray for a fresh outpouring of your spirit. God, I just pray for, regardless of the season, Heavenly Father, God, that you just continue just to reach down and bless and anoint and touch and just let everyone know, Lord Jesus, that you have not forsaken them, you have not abandoned them, that we are still in play for you, Lord God. I just pray that you just help us all to continue further in your kingdom, Lord Jesus. And this next season, God, I just pray that we're all prepared for it. Whatever it is, if some of us are going to be going into a dry season, God, I just pray for us to be able to lay down the foundation. And if some of us are going into the abundance stage, Lord God, I just pray that your anointing, Lord God, just push them to a place that they never thought possible, Lord God. Help them to develop the habits that are needed, Heavenly Father, for us to impact the kingdom of heaven and actually bring that down here on earth, Lord God. And I just praise you and I thank you, because I know some amazing, incredible things are going to be done, especially coming out of this pandemic, Lord God, that what was meant for evil is actually going to be turned and used for your good, Lord Jesus. And I just thank you and I praise your wonderful heavenly name. Amen. So if you are in a dry season, or actually what you need in all seasons, that this is some advice that I have for you. And this is whether you're an adult or a student. And it's this: schedule some time with the Lord, get some accountability in doing so. Find someone that you can ask questions that you're going to have, because we all have questions. I still have questions all the time. And also find somebody and develop a relationship that they have a relationship with God that you want. So I challenge you to make a conscious effort to surround yourself with these sort of people. And that's truly what can make just a huge difference. Man, I can't even tell you how important that other people have been in my walk with Christ. And so that's the reason why that I believe in these principles so much, is because I know that I've applied them to my life. And I can see how just this rapid advancement and, you know, the sanctification process has happened through reading scripture, but then also asking questions and finding people that are killing it for the kingdom like that I want to be. And so, guys, I'm telling you, surround yourself, and that will just change a lot of your lives. I love you, Point students. I miss you. Keep crushing it for the kingdom. I can't wait to worship with you in person very soon. I promise this. This won't last forever. And the awesome thing is that we're closer right now than we ever have been to being together and worshiping in person. And that's a reason to celebrate. And I'm out.